Turn with me in your copy of God's Word to the 8th chapter of the book of the prophet Amos. In the bulletin it's listed, we'll be reading to verse 7, but I'd like for us to go ahead and read on to verse 14 this morning. Amos chapter 8, begin with verse 4. And read on through verse 14. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Shall not the land tremble on this account, and everyone mourn who lives in it, and all of it rise like the Nile, and be tossed about and sink again like the Nile of Egypt? On that day, says the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feasts into mourning, and all your songs into lamentation. I will bring sackcloth on all loins and baldness on every head. I will make it like the morning for an only son, and the end of it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, says the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. In that day the beautiful young women and the young men shall faint for thirst. Those who swear by Shema of Samaria and say, as your God lives, O Dan, and as the way of Beersheba lives, they shall fall and never rise again. May God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Would you pray with me? Eternal God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Lord, this morning I pray for your strength. Strength to stand and share your word, not mine. God, may you give us ears to hear. We may be the kind of people that you call us to be. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I am convinced that there are four collections, shall we say, that every English-speaking American ought to read. One is the New Testament. And I say the New Testament, I mean the whole Bible, but let's face it, people don't usually get past the begots in Genesis before they shut it and put it back on the shelf. So if you can only read half of a book, why not read the better half, the ones with the words of Jesus, the New Testament? So the New Testament's one. The second thing I think every English-speaking American ought to read is every word ever penned on paper by Flannery O'Connor. And if you want any of those words, I think I have all of them on a shelf in my office. The third thing I think we all ought to read is the one novel written by Harriet Beecher Stowe, Uncle Tom's Cabin. I bought my copy for 50 cents at a yard sale in Spiegelville, Texas. And it's one of only two books that have ever moved me to have an emotional response when reading it. The other one is the fourth book, this book, The Grapes of Wrath, by John Steinbeck. Now, if you've seen the John Ford adaptation with Henry Fonda, you get kind of the gist of the story. There's a family named Jode. They live in Oklahoma. And when their son Tom gets out of prison after murdering a guy in a bar fight, they begin to move west to California. They have to move because it's in the middle of what's called the Dust Bowl. There's sharecroppers in Oklahoma, and it's the age of the tractor. Sharecroppers aren't really needed, especially when the land has been ripped dry by the wind. So they pack up in an old Ford truck that they've saved all their money for and head out west. Along the way, before they leave, they pick up a man named Jim Casey. Jim Casey, his initials aren't coincidentally J.C. Steinbeck, I think, writes him as sort of the Christ figure in The Grapes of Wrath. He's definitely the prophetic figure. And when they get out to California, Casey goes off and aligns himself with these protesters. Because out in California, there are these great big ranchers, fruit farmers, who have figured out that all of these migrant workers coming, these Okies from Oklahoma, from Texas, from Arkansas, they'll work for next to nothing. So some of them stand against them. Casey was one of them. And in his stand against these people, he's murdered. And Tom fights back, and Tom becomes a wanted man, and the police and posses pursue him. And in one of the most, I think, amazing scenes in literature, Tom decides he has to leave his family, and so he has a conversation with his mama. Would you all humor me for a minute? Could I read a part of that to you? Would that be okay? You won't fall asleep on me, right? I won't do near as good a job as John Steinbeck would, so I'd like to just share a little snippet from it, from the 27th chapter. And my mind's a little weak, so I'd rather Steinbeck say it than me. This is after he's talked to his mom about some things he's been remembering from Jim Casey. He quotes scripture from Proverbs, the scripture that says, where Solomon says, where one, two are better than one, a threefold cord is not easily broken. And so, after he says this, his mom says, well, that's scripture? And Casey said, yeah, it's called the preacher. That's what Solomon is called in Proverbs. So, mom says, hush, listen. He says, oh, it's only the wind, mom. I know the wind. And I got to thinking, mom, most of the preaching is about the poor we shall have always with us. And if you've got nothing, why, just fold your hands in the heck with it. You're going to get ice cream on gold plates when you're dead. And then this here preacher says two get a better reward for their work. And later on, she asks, she says, Tom, what are you going to do? He says, what Casey done? But they killed him. Yeah, Tom said, he didn't duck quick enough. He was doing nothing against the law, Ma. And I've been thinking a heck of a lot, thinking about our people living like pigs on the good, rich land laying fallow, or maybe one fellow with 1,000,000 acres while 100,000 good farmers is starving. And I've been wondering if all our folks got together and yelled like them fellas yell. Tom, they'll drive you out, cut you down like they done to young Floyd. They're going to drive me anyways. They're driving all our people. So eventually his Ma says, how am I going to know about you? They might kill you, and I wouldn't know. They might hurt you. How am I going to know? And Tom laughed uneasily and said, well, maybe like Casey says, a fella ain't got a soul of his own, but only a big piece of one. And then? Then what, Tom? His mom said. Well, then it don't matter. Then I'll be around in the dark. I'll be everywhere, wherever you look. Wherever there's a fight so hungry people can eat, I'll be there. Wherever there's a cop beating up a guy, I'll be there. If Casey knowed, why, I'll be in the way guys yell when they're mad, and I'll be in the way kids laugh when they're hungry and they know supper's ready. And when our folks eat the stuff they raise and live in the houses they build, why, I'll be there. Tom was angry because these rich farmers with millions of acres were taking advantage of these poor, displaced sharecroppers. It's not too unlike the scene in the northern kingdom of Israel in the last half of the 8th century B.C., in the early part of the 7th century B.C. You see, God had originally laid out this plan for his people. When you come into the land, God said, all the tribes will get an equal share of the land. And in those tribes, all the families will get an equal share of the land. And just in case some things happen along the way, every seventh year, you get it all back. All your debts will be forgiven. If you sold some of your property, you get it back. If you were a slave, guess what? You're freed. If you were an indentured servant, you're freed. Anything that was held against you on the seventh year, it's called Jubilee. It's all forgiven. Can you guess how many times the people of Israel practiced Jubilee? zero. Because they were greedy. Because they knew if they could get more land and more money, and if the seventh year rolled around and they didn't forgive and God didn't smack them off the earth, well, hey, let's just keep it going. And so by the 8th century, there were two classes in Israel. One we might call the 1%, and the other we might call everybody else. There were those who had gained an awful lot of land and an awful lot of money. They were really influential. Under Jeroboam II in Israel, man, everything was just smooth. They were on a gravy train with biscuit wheels. Everything was great. Man, the rich were just getting richer and richer and richer, and there was no empire outside trying to get in. They were peaceful. To walk the streets of Israel may have been to walk the streets of Manhattan. Everything seemed just fine. But then, as we often tend to do, a southerner came and started messing stuff up. Amos was from the southern kingdom of Judah. That's why I like him, a southern boy who goes up to tell the northerners how to do things. 10 miles south of Jerusalem, from a little town called Tekoa, Amos, a sheep-herding fig farmer, gets called by God to go up to Israel, cross the Mason-Dixon line between Israel and Judah, and tell the northern kingdom, to tell the people there, you have wandered away from the way of God. Not because of some things we might think they were doing, but because they were taking advantage of the poor. Amos comes and preaches hard words to the people in Israel. Because, see, they were under this delusion that the good news from God is that you can have more. That the good news is, as the prosperity preachers say it, make God your choice and he'll give you a Rolls Royce. They were under the delusion that God's way meant more and more and more. But here's the thing. The good news of God is not that we can have more. The good news of God is that we can all have plenty. Because you see, the one thing that Amos comes to tell the people in Israel is that God demands fair treatment of all his people. He doesn't say it lightly. God demands fair treatment of all of his people, particularly the poor. And the sad thing is, I'm afraid that we have cultivated a culture that oppresses the poor and abuses the poor. I'll tell you how I know this. I could list several experiences from growing up, but it's one that's simple. One right here, you could do it after church if you wanted. I was coming up from Oxford one day and stopped. You know where Greenbrier Deer Road is in Oxford and on Quintard? I stopped at that green light. And I looked as I drove up Quintard, and I noticed these brightly colored buildings, red and yellow, green and black, red, white, and blue. They had signs on them with titles like Title Pawn, Check to Cash, Cash to Go, that kind of thing. So I decided the next time I drove down Quintard, I'd count and see how many there were. Do you know how many there were between Greenbrier Deer Road and 431? There are 21. That was about a year ago, so they're probably closer to 30 now. 21 of those places. There are fewer places to get a hamburger on Quintard than to get a payday loan. Now, the reason I bring that up is because it was only a few years ago that an actual federal law was passed that limited the interest rate on those kinds of loans. Until then, a person could go in to a check-cashing loan institution and get a loan with a rate equivalent to 400% APR. Does that make sense to you? That means they were being charged 400% interest on those loans. Just recently, Congress passed a law that limited the interest to 36%. We're taking advantage of the poor. We've cultivated a culture in which we take advantage of the poor, and we're not unlike Israel, not in the 7th century. When Amos speaks in verse 4, he says, "Hear this." Now, the way that's phrased is not like, hey, pay attention, this might be important. This isn't phrased from the prophet as in like, hey, this might be something you might want to listen because this might be the consequence of your actions. No, when he says, hear this, he is saying to Israel, you better listen because this is coming whether you like it or not. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring ruin to the poor in the land. Later on, Amos would talk about those who sleep on ivory couches. The women of these wealthy people, he said, were so fat from living so large. He called them cows of Bashan. I mean, Amos, I have a feeling Amos was not a popular guy in Israel. But here, he says, hear this, you who trample on the heads of the poor, the needy, bring them to ruin. They are more concerned about making money than they are about the true worship of God. Their motto of the day was, time is money. You don't have to raise your hand, but I wonder how many of you have ever said that. I wonder how many of you have ever heard that. Time is money. You see it there in verse 5. They say to themselves, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain and the Sabbath that we may offer wheat for sale? In other words, it would be as if right now all of you were lined up at the back door waiting. Waiting for somebody to say amen so you could bust out the door just to go make a dollar. That's what they were doing. They were watching the clock on the Sabbath, waiting for the sun to crack over the horizon to put their workers to the fields to make money. Exploiting those who had nothing. They were putting on a good face at the temple and then going right outside the door to exploit their neighbors, to make a few more dollars. Amos said some words in verse 7 that I think are chilling to me. He says after this, after reprimanding them, in verse 7 he says, the Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Now Amos could have said, the Lord says I will not forget your deeds, and that would have the same linguistic impact, right? I will not forget them. But Amos says that the Lord says, I will never forget their deeds. That's a strong, strong word from God. These people who have taken advantage of the poor, I will never, never forget what they have done. Because God demands from his people fair treatment of all of his people, and particularly the poor. The Latin liberation theologian Gustavo Gutierrez says it this way, God has a preferential option for the poor, and he demands that his people treat them well. Because here's the other thing. Here's the frightening thing behind that. It's not just a suggestion from God. It's not just a word from God that says, hey, it'd be nice if you looked after these poor folks who don't have anything. It'd be nice if you cared for them. No, this is a demand from God. Because the truth is, God judges those harshly who intentionally exploit the poor. And it happens. It happens in ways that we could hardly imagine. I read a story from a BBC reporter named Jamie Doran. Jamie was talking about some children in New York City who were living in these homes and were in foster care. He called it the New York HIV experiment, or the guinea pig kids. There were these children who were a part of the New York City's Administration for Children's Services who were HIV positive. They were born to drug-addicted parents. They were born to parents who were diagnosed with HIV and AIDS. And these children were born HIV positive, given up by their parents because either they couldn't afford them or they didn't have their wits about them. And so New York City's Administration for Children's Services decided they would use these children. They sent nurses to these foster homes, to these homes for children, with needles, with drugs, and said, tell them that you're treating them for HIV. And if they get sick, if they have side effects, well, that's just a part of the HIV. Well, it turns out they were experimenting on the children. They were experimenting with HIV drugs that they might market later on and make millions and millions of dollars with. They were experimenting on these children because they were without parents. They were poor. They had no voice to speak on their behalf, no advocate for these children. And so they said, well, we can exploit them. We can use them. God does not look happily upon these situations. In Israel, we read how the rich were exploiting the poor. They said, we'll make the ephah small. It would be as if you, when you went to get gas this week, you pulled up to the pump and it said 3.15 on the sign. And there was a little asterisk that said 3.15 per half gallon. They were making the measurement smaller, charging the same price, therefore raising their profits. They make the shekel great, the weights that they use to weigh out grain, to weigh out goods. They said, let's make them bigger so people will feel like they're getting more, but really, we're giving them the shaft. They said they practiced deceit with false balances. They were coming in and putting their finger on the balance of the scale and saying, oh, well, it looks like you've got enough today. They were shysters, taking advantage of the people. In fact, they said, you know what? These people are so desperate. They are so desperate for something. I bet when the grain trucks come in, we can sweep the dust off the floor, bag it up, and sell it to them. What are they going to do? They got to eat something. So why not the sweepings of the wheat? They took advantage of the poor. So Amos pronounces God's judgment on them. He talks about an earthquake that will last for 2 months. But there will be such mourning in the land, it will be as if every family had lost their only son, maybe even hearkening back in their mind to Egypt. He uses what's called the day of the Lord language, the day of Yahweh language. And he says, you know what? The end of it all is going to be just as bad as the beginning. This isn't a slap on the wrist that will heal with time. God does not take it lightly. God's judgment on Israel is strong, because coming up over the horizon is Tiglath-Pileser III in the nation of Assyria. And to this day, Israel has not come back together. When Assyria came over the border and God's judgment came on that nation for their treatment of the poor, Israel has never come back together. The tribes are still scattered all over the earth. Israel experienced God's wrath when Assyria conquered them because of the way they treated the poor, because of how they treated the poor among them, because of what they did to those who had nothing and how they took advantage of them. But you know something? It doesn't scare me that God talks about a 2-month earthquake. It doesn't scare me that God's language is one of frightful imagery over apocalyptic language. What scares me is what God says next. Because God says that he will ignore his people who choose to ignore the poor. It's not enough that God is going to judge Israel with violence and a conquering from Assyria. God's going to cut them off. I told you one of the things I think everybody ought to read are the complete works of Flannery O'Connor. I had no idea who she was until seminary. In fact, the first time I heard the name Flannery O'Connor, I said, who was he? It was a man named Lanny French who visited my little church in Texas. One day he had asked if I knew who Flannery was. He said, you kind of talk like her sometimes, which now I take as a compliment I do not deserve. And one day I went out to my pickup after cleaning the church one Friday afternoon, and there in the front seat was a paperback copy of the complete collection of Flannery O'Connor's short stories. I still have it. It's the only one I have. Lanny worked as a park ranger at the big park in Waco. He rode a horse around. It's a cushy job, I guess. But there was a train track that ran through the park. And in the deep, dark part of it, where all the woods grew thick, around that railroad track was an old porta-john, some wooden stools, some crudely made pup tents, and an old broken lazy boy recliner. And a big spot in the middle where the ground was black from fires being burned every night. Lanny called it the hobo jungle. It's where the homeless in Waco who were just transient, just passing through on the train, that's where they stopped. That's where they stayed. And as far as I know, Lanny French is the only person who knows about the hobo jungle in Waco. Nobody knows. And it's not because they don't want to find out. It's because of what we do to the poor among us. We push them to hobo jungles. We push them in projects on the other side of the tracks. We put them in trailer parks. We put them in homes. In some cases, cities have even started programs where they put the homeless on buses and ship them out. We don't want to deal with them. We don't want to deal with the poor. They make our cities look ugly. They make us feel bad. We want to push them away, get them out of our sight. We want to ignore them. And that's what frightens me. Israel wanted to ignore the poor. And so God says through Amos in verse 11, "The time is surely coming when I will send a famine on the land, but not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of the hearing of the words of the Lord." You won't be hungry. You won't be thirsty. In fact, you might just go on living life just fine. But you won't hear from God anymore. They shall wander, he says, from sea to sea, from north to east. Amos says it intentionally because they're not going to go to Judah to find him. "They shall run to and fro seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. In that day, young men and women shall faint for thirst. Those who swear by these other gods will fall and never rise again." Amos says, because of what you have done to the poor among you, because you've ignored them, God will ignore you. God is cutting you off. In fact, the young people in Israel will never hear from God again. I don't know about you, but I'm terrified of God's silence. I would much rather endure some punishment from God than to hear nothing from him. And here the prophet says to the people, "You have ignored the poor, so God will ignore you." He said that to Israel, his own nation. His actual nation. It wasn't conjecture. He called Israel his nation. It wasn't revisionist history. He told Abraham, "You will be the father of my people, of my nation." He led them out of Egypt into the promised land. They were his people. And God says, "I'm cutting you off because of what you've done to the poor." And I hear all the time from all kinds of people that God is going to judge our country because of who we let marry, because of what we do in our schools, because of how Congress votes one way or another. But if God judges our nation, it will be for one thing: the way we have treated the poor, the way we have treated those who do not have what we have. Today, 17 million children will go to bed without eating anything. Think about that. This isn't Africa. We don't live in huts. We don't live in a third world country. We live in the richest country in the world, a country where so many claim that this is God's nation. And 17 million children will go to bed hungry. Think about that. And think about the words from Amos. Words that say, "The time is surely coming." 17 million may go hungry, but church, God's people will go hungry for God if we continue to ignore the poor among us. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, have mercy on us when we are too much like your people Israel. Have mercy on us when we stray away from your path. When we believe that the good news is that we can have more, even at the expense of others. God, help us, your people, to not ignore your people, the poor. Help us see, God, when we think we have nothing, that there are those who have so, so much less, and that you call us to bless them. Jesus, you said, blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of God. If we strive to be your people, that your kingdom may come on earth as it is in heaven, help us, O God, to be people who bless the poor and not people who ignore them. In your holy name we pray.